I want to thank you for having me here today, as well as B&H. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming here. I hope that I'm able to share some of my experiences and some of my techniques with all of you, and you can go home later on and actually apply them to your own photography or your own business as well. Professional photographers here? How many? I could tell. You got that professional look. And aspiring professional photographers, I'm sure the rest of us are. Okay, good. Anybody doing their own printing? Great. And let me see what else. We're going to get into talking about equipment and all that good stuff in a minute. So I just want to give you a little background on myself. I live in Flemington, New Jersey. Professional photographer. I have a business with my business partner Jim Roselli in Hillsboro, New Jersey. And we've been together probably about 4 years. It's actually a pretty new adventure for two of us. He had his own studio before, and I worked on my own. And we decided to collaborate a little bit. He's got the brains, and I kind of have the camera. So we're trying to put two brains together to make one big brain. I grew up in Brooklyn, Bensonhurst, and so I'm what you call a native. I'm still a New Yorker. I don't know if you can tell by my slight accent. Spumoni Gardens, anyone in Brooklyn? Anyone? Spumoni Gardens? Okay, thank you. Yes. So anyway, we talked about questions. What I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a couple of things, and then probably towards the half part of this program, we'll stop for a little bit, have some questions and answers as well, and then maybe take a slight break. I want to make sure that everything's set up properly, and then we'll finish off in the afternoon. We'll do some Lightroom, do some printing, and we'll do some Photoshop. Maybe we'll show you some cool little retouching of Photoshop as well. No questions. Okay. And I just want to give you a little more heads up on my photography career. I got started very late. Actually, probably I was about 40 years old when I got interested in professional photography. After an early retirement from my other job, I moved out to New Jersey and joined the camera club. And somebody asked me if I'd like to help them shoot weddings. And unfortunately, I said yes. And the rest is history. No. It was was a wonderful way to make a living back then. It's a little bit tougher now. So I haven't done it probably in about 10 years, but I did work at doing weddings, and that's how I learned my photography. I also joined a couple of different organizations, which helped me as well learn how to take my images up to another level. PPA, national organization. I also belong to state organizations, PPA and J, which is an affiliate. I love to go to camera clubs and speak there because I always love talking to people that are up and coming and trying to get a handle on what photography is all about. So at age 40, I really started to get interested in learning how to pick up the pace a little bit. So what I did was I learned a little bit about digital. I loved black and white, so Ansel Adams was one of my favorite photographers, and I said, wow, just to get something that looks a little bit like that would be awesome. So, but I didn't want to invest into a darkroom system, and digital was coming upon us, and I figured, well, maybe I could use the computer as my digital darkroom, and that's what I ended up doing. I took a quick class in Photoshop and went online, I read about it, tried to figure out how I can implement that into my own type of photography, and the rest is really history. I continue to go to these organizations. I do a lot of print competitions because it keeps my juices flowing. And we'll talk a little bit about that. Some people find it to be not their thing, and some find it to be very helpful. So we can talk a little bit about that as the program goes on. So let me talk a little bit about coming back in here, and let's hit this. And we'll talk a little bit about what I do and how we do it. some of the things we're going to cover today. We're going to talk about techniques, how to improve photography. Talk about street photography, something that I love to do. You'll see a lot of my photography is homeless people or senior citizens. I have a really soft spot in my heart for those people, as well as I've been to Haiti several times and I'm looking to go back there, another place that has been an amazing journey for myself. I'm going to show you a couple of slideshows from Haiti that hopefully will inspire you, and then we'll go into Lightroom, talk about the Lightroom modules a little bit, then into Photoshop, maybe we'll do some retouching, and of course then we're going to do some printing as well, and then hopefully we'll have some time for questions and answers. Okay, it's about the L factor, and I guess we all have a common reason for being photographers. I'm still trying to figure out what my purpose is, but I guess it's, I don't know, to give our clients, if we're professional photographers or if we're not professional photographers, if we're our family members or friends or whatever, to give them the best that we can. And I think that's the bottom line. We're seeing a lot of amateur photographers coming into the market and unfortunately hurting a lot of professional photographers because of, I would say, one of the main reasons. Most of them aren't full-time, so they are part-time photographers. Digital equipment has gotten so much better over the years, it's like scary. You know, almost anybody can take a decent picture. And of course, it's the money. People do not want to pay. I shouldn't say never, but it's not like it used to be. I used to be able to go out and I only did weddings by myself. I used to book 30 to 40 weddings a year for myself. That was fine. There were photographers out there that were doing hundreds of weddings a year. They are now without a studio. They've closed down. They've moved out. It's just the work is not there anymore. And not only for photographers, also for the reception halls as well. So it's a problem that we have to think about. But if we can give our clients or our friends or whoever we're photographing for, if we can give them something that's a little bit different than the amateur photographers, and don't get me wrong, there are great amateur photographers out there, but you know there are plenty of people are out there that just don't get it, and hopefully we can rise above them and give ourselves a chance to be on top. So I think I was touched upon this a little bit before. So is it the equipment? Well, we could talk about that all day, and I guess that will be coming up. Canon's the best, Sony's the best, Nikon's the best. Well, I don't know. I don't really think it's the equipment at this point. And the reason why is we see these photographers out there that are just picking up these digital cameras, and they're creating pretty decent images at this point. But I don't think that's the bottom line. I think when they step it up a notch and try and do something that a professional photographer can do, I think that's where they fall short. So I think it's all about knowing our equipment. I think that's the most important thing to photography, knowing your capabilities of your equipment. Can it shoot in low light? How fast can it shoot? What's the focusing systems like? There's so many different things that you need to learn about your equipment if you want to get the best results out of that. Okay, so understand its capabilities, and of course, understand its limitations. How far can you push it? Some cameras are great for shooting low light. There are a couple of them that I use is the D3S, D4. These cameras are exceptional shooting at very high ISOs. You can shoot at 4, 5, 6,000 ISO, 8,000. I shoot at 10,000 if I have to. There was a time when you would just miss the shot because your camera couldn't get it. Now, all right, so show some noise. Who cares? If it's a shot of a lifetime, let's get it. And if you have a decent exposure on your image, that noise is not objectionable. It's okay. It's noise like we used to get when we used high-speed film. So that's okay. The noise that we do not want is the noise that we get from underexposing our images. That's the problem. And then when we start to bring in information from that low end of the histogram, we're bringing in all kinds of garbage. We're bringing in information that's not there. It's trying to make up information. That's why you see all these red, greens, all ugly color noise, that's the problem. So that's something that you want to try to avoid. So understand your camera, understand its limitations and its capabilities. Okay, so I mentioned just a minute ago that a lot of photographers have closed down their studios and they've decided to work out of their homes because it's obvious that they just couldn't afford to keep a running studio going because the work was not there. And I did this for many, many years. When I started photography, I turned my small basement into a studio with my wife not happy, kicking and screaming, but we did it anyway. And we were able to get, you know, maybe I could get three people down there and do a portrait. And it was great at that point. I loved it. And I continued to use my home. And then I decided, well, you know what? It's really not for me. I really like using available light. That's my take on photography. I like to use Mother Nature's light as my source. There's nothing wrong with using strobes. I use strobes sometimes, and some of my photography you saw did you? I was using strobes. It's fine. But I said to myself, well, if I use Mother Nature's light, I can go outside and use the outdoors as my studio. And I have more, I can give my clients much more to pick from instead of shooting them in front of a canvas background or a seamless paper background, whatever it might be, whatever the case might be. I decided, well, I can go outside and maybe they have a special place that means more to them than standing in my studio. And it worked very well. You know, people would rather have their home used as a backdrop, saying something more special to them than just, you know, looking at a paper background. And then what happened throughout the years, as I got more proficient in digital photography, I said, well, I can take this up another step. And that other step was taking them outside, finding backgrounds that may not be conducive to a beautiful background, and then dropping in my own background. And I've done very, very well with that. And when I say drop in backgrounds, we're talking about extracting people from where they are and putting in whatever I wanted to put in. On my slideshow, there's a couple things there that weren't real. I'm sure you could tell. Like that Frankfurter guy with the soubrette there, you know, somewhere in God's country, you know, that's something I decided to put together. And what's really nice about it is, just like in a digital darkroom, you have the ability to dodge and burn and manipulate, and that's been going on forever and ever. In a digital darkroom, yes, you can burn, you can dodge, you can manipulate somewhat, and then you can go berserk. Okay, so there's a fine line depending on what you're looking to do. I tried some HDR. You saw some of that. It's not my HDR is okay. Again, don't get me wrong. You're able to capture a scene that would be impossible to catch with one shot. HDR would be using multiple shots to combine the exposure. In other words, if it was you got too much one end of the spectrum is so light and the other one's dark, your camera can only capture so much of that, and the rest is going to be lost. So HDR, high dynamic range, you can capture several of them and blend them all together, which is very nice. And just try to keep it to a minimum. Don't go berserk on it, and it'll look very natural, and it looks very, very nice. So, so it doesn't make a difference if it's in a location, you're in a studio, you still want to be ready to shoot. Always have your camera ready to go and get out there and just have a good time. So what are some of the ways to kind of improve your images? Well, we're doing it right now. We're associating with other photographers, which is great because you might know something that I don't know. Just because you may not be a professional photographer doesn't mean that you don't have your own agenda on the way you photograph. So you might know something that really is good for your type of photography, and who knows, maybe I would like to know that. So I think being together in a forum like this is great. This way we can share with each other, share our knowledge, share our questions. All these things are great. And that's one of the reasons why I like to go to these associations and pick people's brains. It's all good. And assimilate your knowledge. So, you know, share with each other. That's something that I'd love to do because there's plenty of room for everybody out there. I want to be able to share my experiences and also my techniques with everybody, and hopefully that will help them grow and learn in this field. And then once you get that all together, try to incorporate that into your workflow. We can talk about workflow as a whole other subject that we can talk about all day. I use Lightroom for my workflow. That's where it starts. Lightroom, anyone? Photoshop RAW, okay. And Nikon, okay, Nikon, okay. They're all great. They really are. They all are great. And the reason why I use Lightroom, not only is it a RAW converter, it's an amazing database system, okay? And that's really why I use Lightroom. So, database? Yeah. You know, when you start shooting into hundreds of thousands of images and you want to find Aunt Mary on the beach in New Jersey, where are you going to go? Well, you go into Lightroom and go Aunt Mary, beach, New Jersey, and poof, here she comes. Keywording, extremely, extremely important when you start working, going into a workflow. So keywording is start putting in your things for every image. And you know, if you're at a beach in New Jersey, you're at Asbury Park, and you shoot 300 images there, when you get into Lightroom, on the keywords, you go Asbury Park, New Jersey, and you apply it to all of them, boom. And then eventually you can start picking up the pace for each one. If one has water in it, waves, if one's on the boardwalk, you put all the stuff in. And this is the way you build up your keyword systems, and this is how you manage your images. So that's why I use Lightroom. Bridge is great, and I used to use Bridge all the time. It's not as powerful. Bridge is a browser, and in other words, what that means is when you open up Bridge can see everything that's on your computer or anything that's plugged into the computer. It finds it, and it's great. Lightroom does not know where your images are unless you import them into Lightroom first. Otherwise, it has no clue where to find them. So, two different animals. They all have great points about them. And again, the reason I put Lightroom to my workflow is for the data management system. Okay. I guess this whole thing about learning photography, there is a foundation. You just don't. For most of us, me included, I didn't just wake up and, you know, all of a sudden, wow, you know, guy got the best images in the world, and I probably still don't. I'm still working and thriving for that. But you got to start somewhere. So if you guys got your cameras, if it's point and shoots or whatever it is. By the way, the point and shoot cameras nowadays are another crazy thing. They're just amazing. I think Canon just came out with a new the G16 or whatever it is, whatever they're up to, and those cameras are just unbelievable. We did a test at the studio. We shot some things. One was on a D3X, and the other one was on a G12, 13 for one of those. And you know, then we showed it to the camera club people, and you know, not only couldn't they tell the difference, some of them picked the point and shoot. So. Once again, it's not the equipment, it's how we use the equipment, okay? So we need a building block to get going. And so how do we build these blocks? For me, and again, it may not be for everybody, for me, I follow some simple rules. And these rules don't mean they're in stone and you gotta go by this, otherwise your image is gonna be garbage. It's a foundation, it's a building block, that's all it is. And what are these rules? These rules I picked up from an association, and it makes sense to me, and that's one of the reasons why I kind of gear my mind towards that when I'm thinking about photography. So we can learn these rules, and like I said before, we can break the rules as well. Once we understand the rules, it's okay to kind of take it to another level and see if we can, you know, break those rules and have a good time. So for me, I'm always listening to my, you know, what is it about this scene? What is it about this person? What is it telling me? Why am I intrigued? Why am I stopping? Does this person inspire me? Does this person make me feel sad? Does this person make me laugh? Whatever it might be. Is this scene a nighttime scene with a sunset? Is just the colors of the sky? What is it that made me stop and want to take a look at it? And then once I find that out, let's go explore it a little bit. And maybe my first shot may not be what I thought it was going to be. And that's why we talk about trial and error. Trial and error is, I mean, for me, it's everything. I can't say that my first shot is like, wow, that's what I wanted. I do have a vision. I kind of visualize. If we all know Ansel Adams, he was an amazing photographer. And he was even a more amazing photographer in the darkroom. He was able to kind of visualize where he wanted his photography to go. And I kind of do that. I see a scene and I say to myself, wow, it's really nice, but I want it to be here. I want to go to the next level, and how do I do that? So I try to keep that in my mind. And I also try to be different from everybody else. And it's okay to copy somebody's technique, but I think when it's all said and done, you want to be your own person. You want to have your own look. I think that's very, very important. So when somebody sees your photography, they say, I know who photographed that. I could tell. I can tell by his style. All right. So that's important as well. So these rules or elements. Has anybody seen these rules before? Or know anything about it? Okay. These rules are from the National Association of Professional PPA, Professional Association of America. And they put out these rules not only for print competition, but also for allowing you to bring your photography up a couple of notches. It's pretty simple when you look at some of these elements, why your images will pick up its pace. Impact. So when somebody first sees your image, what does it do to them? Is it a good reaction? Is it a bad reaction? Is it there some reaction, an impact? That's good. They may have something negative to say about it, but maybe it said something to them, and that's okay. Not everybody has to love you, you know, that particular image. We talked about knowing your camera and its limitations, technical excellence. So yeah, you want to make sure you have the right exposure. Did you accomplish what you wanted to? Did you want a slow shutter speed so you can see movement in the water? Did you want a quick, very fast shutter speed so you can stop this tennis player in midair slamming a ball? By the way, Rafael Nadal did a good job last night. I don't know if anybody saw that. What a match. Style, and I was just talking about that. Do you have your own style? What is it that you like to do? Are you a black and white photographer? Are you do you photograph children? Do you, whatever it might be, do you have your own style? Composition, without a doubt, it goes without saying. Most people, they like to take a camera and they photograph Aunt Mary and bam, she's right dead center, right in the middle of the frame. Every time, without a doubt, because that's what we think is right. Think about composition, and we're gonna go over that a little bit as well. We're going to talk about rules of thirds, which is very important in your composition. Presentation, pretty important. So once we got our image and it's beautiful and we want to print it out, we want to present it to somebody, what are we doing with it? Are we, I don't know, are we going to mat it? Are we going to frame it? All these little things. So we got a beautiful image and then we just throw it in a $4 frame and all of a sudden your image doesn't look that well anymore. So all these things will help your imagery look much better. Is there a center of interest? So when somebody looks at your image, are they kind of looking around and saying, what's going on? I'm not too sure what I'm looking at. Is there a center of interest so that you can take your viewer's eyes into that area and tell them the story that you want to tell them? Your lighting, we talked about that a little before. So is it high key? Is it low key? All these little things we have to think about. Is it side lighting? Is it three-quarter lighting? Is it profile? Is it two-thirds? There's so many things we have to think about. So when we're photographing a person, we have to think about the proper lighting on their face. You know, I could backlight somebody. That could be proper, and then just kind of come in and fill the light in the front of the faces if that's what I wanted to do. If I'm photographing somebody in a studio, I'm thinking about where I'm positioning the light and positioning their face as well. These are all things that will make your clients look better. You know, there's short lighting, there's broad lighting. For the most part, when somebody's very heavy, you don't want to broad light them, it's just going to make them look that much heavier. Broad lighting is when the the highlight side of the face is facing the lens. Short lighting is when the shadow side of the face is facing the lens, and usually that's more flattering. Subject matter, you know, we talked about that a little bit. What, you know, try to tell your audience what it's you want to convey to them. Your technique. So again, talked about some people like to do HDR, like I said before. That's a technique. Some people like to use filters, plugins. That's a technique. There are millions of plugins. We all know what a plugin is, right? Yes? No? Okay, you can answer that. And when I said about asking questions, that one you could answer. Yes, so it's a third. These are third-party plugins from third-party companies that allow you to bring these into Photoshop, Lightroom, all these little things. Some of them are free. Some of them you pay for. There's billions of them out there. It's just crazy where you finally settle down to. I use a couple. I don't go crazy. I have them, quite a few of them, but there's only a few that I really finally end up using. Storytelling. I think that's really very important in your image. Showing your client or a friend, what is it you want to relate in this particular image? What is the story you wanted to tell them? Is it a little baby that was just born and the mother holding it close to her breast? Is it a child that is crying? Just uncontrollably. What is the story that you want to get out there? I mean, you could take a picture of a child crying. You may not have the right angle. You may not have the right position, and it all falls apart. So all these things play a role. One more. I'll take another step into this competition. It's nice to get awards. I thank you, Mark, for mentioning some of mine, and I do like getting them. It's okay. But it's like a pat on the back. You got this, you got that. It's really cool. And a lot of people say, well, it's not making me any money. But you know what? Yes, it can make you money, because if your photography is better and is improving and better than this, you're another photographer or an amateur, you would be the person that they're going to hire. So yes, understand photography. Understand some of these rules that we're talking about. And forget about the monetary part of it, but the educational award is amazing, because it's a non-ending lifetime of learning for me. I would never admit to the fact that I know everything, because there's so much to know. It's just insane. I think you just have to keep pushing yourself, keep learning, educate yourself, and you will definitely become a better photographer. So. Competitions do not make you money, but understanding how to make a better image will. And that's how they all fall into place for me. Excuse me. So. It is a touchy subject, these 12 elements and this stuff, and client versus competition, and people really get bent out of shape. Anybody put their images into a competition? Okay, cool. So local, like a local competition?
Sometimes.
Okay, good. Well, I think that's great. You know why? A couple of things. You get feedback. You get feedback from other people that look at your work. And you know what? When I do my competitions, sometimes I'll ask, because you fall in love with your images, and this is what you see. You know, you don't go this far, you just go this far. So sometimes it's good to send your stuff out, get some feedback. Maybe there's something in there that you're not seeing and somebody else is, and you say, man, I can't believe it. Yeah, of course. So it's great. Some people don't want to go into competitions because they get nervous. They get afraid. What is the judge going to, what's he going to say? What is he going to say about my print? He doesn't like it. He thinks he's going to put me down. You know what? What you give your clients and what you give a judge are two different animals. You have to sometimes play the judge's game if you want to do well in print competition. and not necessarily have to do that for your clients. Your clients are more forgiving, let me tell you. They're not looking for every little nook and cranny that you missed, or a little spot here, or a little something that was a little out of place there. They're looking at their beautiful child's face. In print competition, they're not doing that. They're dissecting this whole image. So do not get bent out of shape. Take it for what it's worth. It's only one person's opinion. And move on, and just, again, learn from the experience, and just move on and try and continue to work with your imagery. So, like I said before, camera, pixels, or emotion. For me, it's all about the emotion of the image. You could take this image with almost any camera. It doesn't make a difference. If it was 5 megapixels, if it was 36 megapixels, you can get this image. So it's not about the pixels, it's about what you're capturing, okay? A couple of quotes. When words become unclear, I shall focus with photographs. When images become inadequate, I shall be content with silence. That's from Ansel Adams, and I think it's a beautiful quote, and it really, really says a lot. A gentleman dragged his photography up hills with a mule. Boy, I thought I had problems. You know, like my shoes, I didn't like the way they felt when I walked up the hill. He's got a mule. But he captured things that were just incredible. But he also understood that sometimes you can't even capture it, what you're feeling inside your heart. You can't even capture it, and that's what he says. And that's when he'll just stand there and look and be silent and appreciate what life has to offer, which is, I think, is just incredible.
Can you wait just 1 second?
Of course. Sure. It's a lot deeper than when you first look at it. Think about it. It really is a very, and this next one cracks me up, from our one of our presidents, Abraham Lincoln. There are no bad pictures. That's just how your face looks sometimes. And, you know, here's a guy that had a long face to begin with, so maybe he knew what he was talking about. Okay, so let me bring up some tips and candidates and this stuff here. Let me close this, and let's get going on this. Okay. Well, obviously, if you don't have it, you're not going to get it, all right? So this sounds so silly, but, you know, I got mine. I don't leave without it, especially when you come into New York City. God, I mean, there's stuff all around here you can't miss. People, places, stuff. So, carry a camera with you. I mean, if you're photographers, God, I mean, don't you? I mean, that goes without saying. Don't leave home without it. All kidding aside, it's the only way you're going to learn how your camera works. You're going to learn about yourself. You're going to learn about what makes you tick, what you feel. Take it with you, and, you know, don't be afraid. Experiment. It's digital. It used to be $1, $1, $1, $1. Now the worst part about it is post-processing. We, you know, shoot 20,000 images and, you know, we go berserk. And we're over in the computer for 7 weeks trying to figure out what the hell did I shoot. So, you know, there's a happy line in there. First time I went to Haiti, I shot 7,000 images. Why? Because I was so freaking crazy, I just didn't know what to do. And it kind of tempered down a little bit. My last trip, probably about 3,000, which is okay. Be spontaneous, and it's true. Your friends and relatives, test it out on them. I go to all my friends' barbecues, picnics, all these things, and I get crazy shots of their beautiful children or whatever's going on, because I'm just spying. I got the long lens, and I'm spying. I go around and get the greatest images by just beautiful candids, you know. Kids don't look at you, and, you know, with the missing teeth, and they're smiling. Don't smile. It's okay. Just go away. I'll follow you around, and that's what I do. I follow them around. I wait for the right moments, and then I take my picture. I look for the right lighting, everything that makes for a great image. So friends are really cool to experiment with. Try to be inconspicuous. Well, what? Okay, he's shooting something, God knows how many, maybe a mile away. Nobody knows he's shooting, but just to A little laugh, yes. So longer lens, your clients will be more at ease. 7200 is my go-to lens for portraits, although I have an 85, 1.4. And I use wide angles too. Carry everything that I can fit in that little bag there, and then I throw one more in my carry-on. So I do use long lenses for the most part, unless I really want to get something a little more unique and something a little crazy. And we're going to talk about perspectives and trying to get changing the way you see photography. So, but it will make your clients or friends or whoever they are a little more at ease, so you're not on top of their face. Smile, smile, smile. Just get away, move away, just be in the background, put on a trench coat and go hide somewhere. Okay. For me, when I leave the flash at home, I don't. I take it with me because you never know, but I very, very rarely put it on, unless it's a last ditch type of thing. So I kind of like to look around and learn what the lighting is doing, what the natural light is doing. That's what really pumps me up. I like to see the light, understand the light. It's there. You just got to learn, you know, train yourself to say, wow, look at that. And I'm sure we've all done it. We know what beautiful lighting is. Now we have to apply it. For me, if I'm shooting a person, I have to apply that beautiful lighting to someone's face. So it's a little bit different than landscape, but it's they all need the same thing. They all need light, okay? We're all looking for the light. I just did a program in Long Island, and it was looking for the light. And unfortunately, it rained, but we got some beautiful imagery just finding, you know, little buildings with little archways and stuff like that, and seeing the light coming in underneath them. We all know, I shot people out in midday, which everybody says is the worst time to shoot somebody, you know, 12 o'clock, the sun is straight up. You can use different materials to make that a beautiful photograph. So I look for Mother Nature's light. I also look for backgrounds that are conducive to making it a nice image. Remember, we talked a little bit about it's not only about the person. When you're doing a photograph, it's about everything. So is the background, does the background work with them? Does it fight the image? So those are all the things I talked about before, about these rules. All these things come into play. So learn to see the light. Go out there. I run around like a maniac. Is it soft light? Is it hard light? And I talked about it a second ago about daylight. 12 o'clock in the afternoon, the light is hitting her in the face just like this. It's really pretty ugly. So you take out a diffuser. You put a diffuser in front of the light. A light, the face gets beautifully lit. You bring out a reflector underneath her, catch some light back into the face, and you got a beautiful portrait without hardly doing anything. So there are ways to invent the light as well. Model releases. Everybody always asks me about model releases, and it's important. I try to get it whenever I can. Haiti is it's a tough situation. We stay with a priest. So whenever I can, I talk to him. Can you talk to them? Get this, because I can't communicate. They speak Creole. But I will photograph somebody before if I have to. If I'm going to lose the shot, I'm going to shoot it and then do my thing. So I guess what I'm trying to say is try and get a model release if you're shooting somebody. It really is very important. When I do homeless people, it's very rare that they want to sign a model release. So I guess you have to use your common sense there. So, for me, talking about candidates, I keep it very simple because I don't want to think too much. I want to get the shot. So, some of the newer cameras now are pretty incredible, very accurate. This is not the way I shoot all the time, auto, 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 auto. I shoot a lot manual as well. It really depends on the situation. But if I'm running around in Haiti, or if I'm running around in New York City, and I want to grab something very quickly, I don't want to worry about what's happening. I want to think about getting the shot. So I shoot an aperture priority. That's just my thing. I like to control, my depth of field, and I see where my shutter speed's going to fall at that point. If I need more warp speed, then I'm going to pick up my ISO, make it a little higher, whatever it might be. So I'm very aware of my shutter speed, obviously. If I'm shooting kids, First of all, I want to know the depth of field. Most of my stuff, these kids are wide open. I shoot a 2.8. I'm not afraid to shoot a 2.8. Nobody really should be. The point is, you want to separate them from the background for the most part. That's what makes your image look so dimensional, is to not for them to be blending in with your background. You want them to be popping out of that image. So for the most part, wider apertures. I look at my shutter speed, make sure it falls where I want, where I'm comfortable that I can hand hold it. If you use a tripod, I use tripods, but not for people. It's just too cumbersome for me. I need to be quick. You know, set up a tripod, come down, come up, do this, do that. So that's why I prefer to have a camera that shoots a higher ISO, so I can run around and shoot ambient light, not worry about flashes. Remember, you can use fill flash to your advantage, and it can look very natural. But for me, I still enjoy using the Mother Nature's light and then worrying about, you know, maybe popping it a little bit in post-production. So so wide open, auto exposure. Sometimes I'll have it on single spot. If I'm shooting one person, it's single spot. It's nice and easy. You don't have to worry about it. I'll tell you one thing that I've learned. If you're shooting with an 85, 1.4, 1.2 with the Canons, and you're shooting wide open, you better nail it, because if you don't, you have no clue how thin the margin is of focus on those cameras. And I know we all do it. I've done it. If you focus on the person's eye and recompose, you're going to lose the eyes. If it's wide open, the eyes are gone. So don't forget to use your focusing points. Get it up on top of there and focus on the eye so you don't have to move anymore. You're already composed, and just shoot. Because it could be acceptable, but it's not perfection. I look for perfection. I want sharpness, especially if you're shooting somebody. Their eyes need to be sharp. Not always, but 99% of the times. So manual, do I shoot manual? Yes. If I know that I'm going to be in an area that it's not changing, and say I know that it's something that has a little more backlight to it, and it's going to fool my camera, then I'm going to go on manual and shoot it that way. So this way, anytime I move in, I do this way, it's going to stay just where it is. I don't have to worry about that backlight cheating on the camera and underexposing. Speaking of underexposing, it's one thing you do not want to do. I guess we can talk about that when we get into Lightroom. Please be considerate of the people that you're photographing. You know, put yourself in their place. If they seem to be uncomfortable, just get away, walk away, and it's all good. There'll be somebody else. And always share what you're photographing with them. Shooting from the hip. Well, New York City is a great place to do that. I mean, just go out and knock yourself out. I get some crazy, crazy images from doing this. And when I say shooting from the hip, there's a couple of ways you can do it. If you really want to be sneaky, this is really, don't tell anybody. This is really cool. Just take your camera, put it on your neck. Now get it tighten up so it's kind of like over here. This is really bad. You shouldn't do this. This is bad. Take your shutter release and put it in your pocket, okay? And just walk around and shoot your hearts out. People have, they don't, you know, and just, you get crazy stuff. And it's wild. It really is. I've done it. I get some really nice results from it. Otherwise, you can walk around shooting this way as well. Some of the things you want to be concerned with when you're shooting this way is shutter speeds. You know, if you're looking to stop the action, of course you want it a little bit faster. If you like motion, then you can drag the shutter a little bit. That's fine. A wider angle, so it'll give you a more comfort zone to capture the image without it being out of focus or capturing exactly what you want. You can use both manual and autofocus. And when I say that, if you know what your camera's going to throw out, you know, from 2 to 12 feet, you can set it to that and bang, bang, bang. If not, you can use auto. I just put it on multi-focusing and, you know, closest to the camera. And you can use that as well, and it'll when it's in focus, she'll go off. It's just fun. It's another way just to get your brains working and doing something that's a little bit different. Continuous focus is also cool. This way, every time somebody's moving, it will continue to focus on them. And then, of course, you can set your camera to continuous, so stuff like that. Like I said before, it's a digital world, so don't be afraid. Please go out there and just knock yourself out. Have a good time. Shoot. The only thing that's going to cause a problem is your post-production, getting back in the computer and saying, what did I do? Why did I shoot this? But it's okay. You know, it's all fun and games. All right. Don't be afraid to get your hands dirty. And one of the reasons I really wanted you to see this was we're all so used to walking up and taking pictures from this position because I don't want to bend. I don't want to go there. I don't want to bend. I don't want to do this, God forbid. But let me tell you, if you do that, you will start seeing your images look so much different, different perspectives. So get low, get high, do something that's different than eye level. If you're shooting a landscape, and I would recommend if you are shooting landscape, please use a tripod. That's when I would insist to use a tripod. Also, cable releases, all those good stuff. But get in there. Instead of just, you know, seeing what you see when we walk, get down low. You'll be surprised at what you see, what you didn't see, you know, from up there when you get down there. So experiment. Don't be so apt to take a picture from, you know, eye level. Get down, get up, try different angles. Also, try different lenses on the same shot. Sometimes a good exercise is just to go out with one lens. And I usually go from the extreme. So I'll go out either with a super wide angle or something really crazy long, fixed lens, and just shoot and see what I could do. This way, I'm not zooming in, zooming out. I have to use that lens for what it is. And it's a good exercise. I said before, families, barbecues, these are great places to go. You got a million of them here right in New York City. God, I love coming in here and going to the festivals, the food festivals down the street, and just people, they love to have their pictures taken, especially ballparks and things like that. They live for that. They see your face and they just light up and, you know, take my face, take my picture. So it's a good way, again, for you to understand the limitations of your camera or the limitations of yourself at that point until you start to learn a little bit more of how your camera actually works. Great places to go. This is, it sounds a little silly, but yeah. If you're going to do a shoot, being a wedding photographer years ago, I never wanted surprises, you know, so trying to get an idea of what am I shooting, where am I shooting, when am I shooting, all these little things will play a role in how your final product comes out. So if you're shooting real estate, you want to find out what time of the day is the best time to shoot that home. Is, you know, do you want it the sun right smacking, hitting it early morning? Do you want it in later afternoon? How's the house facing? All these little things play a role. So have a plan. This way you'll know what lenses to take. You'll know what equipment you're going to need to shoot that. So it'll give you a little more time to be prepared. I got here early because I live in New Jersey and I was afraid that the tunnel would not let me in here. So I left nice and early and I want to be prepared. The worst thing I want to do is show up somewhere and not equipped or have the knowledge of what I need to do. This wasn't real. You can see that. I like to do montages. These are some of the things I like to do. I like to get in there and think about visualizing. So when I say get the real picture, what I really mean about getting the real picture is life is the real picture. Every day that we're able to get up, put our feet on the floor, go out there and do what we love the most, that's the real picture, guys. So it doesn't matter what the subject is, it doesn't matter what time of the day it is, it doesn't matter what it is. It's all about what you feel inside yourself and how you want to project that to other people. I think that's what the real picture is. Get the big picture, guys, and it's more than just photography, it's everything that's around us. My dad just passed away just recently, so this program is dedicated to him, and that's what I said, what I meant about getting the real picture. You saw this before. This my dad was just short of his 96th birthday, So he lived a beautiful, long life, and I appreciate that he was in my life for so many years. So that's what I'm talking about, getting that big picture. Thank you to my sponsors, especially Moab. Just wanted to say a little bit real quickly about Moab's products. They make some terrific papers, and besides papers, they also make other things like presentation books and folios that you can for carrying around, so you can keep your images in archival boxes. I have a Shinley book up here later on when we break, you can take a look at some of the Shinley book, how that's made. It's a beautiful, beautiful product. All right, so what's next on the agenda? Let's go into Lightroom. We'll talk a little bit about workflows, okay? So let me drag this, and let's do this so we can. Okay, so I'm just gonna import those two. I'm gonna move them in. And add them. They're on my desktop somewhere. Desktop. And uncheck all. And I'm just going to bring these two raw files in. We know they're raw. It says NEF. That's Nikon's raw file format. Import them. So right now I'm in what they call the library mode. And remember, we talked a little bit about keywording. This is the area where you would do your keywording. I actually have a list that I use. It's got a couple hundred thousand words in it. And I continue to, make that grow. So this is where you would put them in. And for this one, I would put in baby, child, hat, costume, blah, blah, blah. So we talked about resolution. So I would go into, first of all, the library mode is where all your images live. And let me just go back here. And that's the V&H slideshow. Okay. Once I have everything in here and I have it keyworded, the next step I would do is go into what the development mode. Let me see if I can pull down. Here's your modes up on the top here. Library, develop, map. I never used it. Book. This is really very cool for you, for people that are actually making their own books now. Adobe hooked up with Blurb, B-L-U-R-B. And they are now working in conjunction with each other. And you can do all your templates right here in Lightroom. Upload them right to Blurb, and you have a book. Slideshows are cool. Print out of Lightroom, and you can make web pages in here as well. So let's just take this one, and we're going to go into the develop mode. This is where we start working on our image. Is it overexposed? Is it underexposed? People, do we understand what the histogram is? Okay, the right side of the histogram is your highlights. Left side is your shadows, and are there perfect histograms? No. They're not. Some of them may lean to the right, some may lean to the left. What I will tell you is make sure that you don't underexpose your images. If anything, on the back of your camera, what you are seeing is a JPEG representation of that image, not a raw file. So if it's hovering near the right, you still have some more room to play. Just don't underexpose it, because that's when you start getting to problems. Most of our information on that digital file is on the right-hand side of the histogram. Okay? Very little is in the shadow area. Very little information is there. So it's almost like back in the slide days, a little bit like that. But anyway, I take a look at my histogram. I'm taking a look and see what I need to do. And I start from, all the modules start, look very, very similar. You always start from the top and move to the bottom. Here I can change my color temperature, the tinting. I can also pick, this is an eyedropper tool that picks a neutral gray. So if I come back in here, if you look on the top left-hand side, we have a little navigator. And if I move that thing around, it shows me what the color is going to look like if I click on the baby's face. But if I click somewhere on the neutral gray, it didn't move much because I had a white balance set. So, but that's one of the ways you can do it. For me, it looks like it's too overexposed. So there's a couple of things. What's new in 4 and or in 5, I'm sorry, new in 5 is this highlight slider. That's That's brand new. Before it was recovery. It was called a recovery slider, and it really didn't. It worked okay, but it hit more than just the highlights, and that was a problem. So they came out the highlight, just to show you. I'm just going to drag this, and it really hits more of the right side of the histogram, as you can see. All right, so I can come down in here, or if I leave it alone, if you double click, it goes back to zero. If I pull down my, I wouldn't use my exposure. I could use a little bit of the exposure, but you know what? I'm going to use the highlight because I'm not really that overexposed. It's just the face. So I'm just going to drag that down so we can see a little bit more. I look at my left side, and this is just about where it needs to be. Maybe some shadow underneath or right in here is clipping a little bit. You know what? It's okay. Remember before I said there's no perfect histogram. If we take a picture of a card that's black one-third, gray one-third, white one-third, and we shoot that, do we know what our histogram is going to look like? It's going to be three spikes. That's it. It's going to be one black spike on the left, a black spike on the right, and one spike dead center. That's a perfect histogram for that card. Okay, so that's what we have to understand. If we're shooting outdoors, a white polar bear in the snow, it's going to be mostly on the highlight side. We're not going to be able to get all that whole histogram. We can drag it down a little bit, see if we can pick up some more shadow detail, but it may not work. So don't get too bent out of shape for that. So I'm going to bring down the highlights a little bit. And I'm going to explain it to you. There's so many things you can do in Lightroom. Lightroom has gotten a lot better. They're coming out with more tools now. But for me, that's not where I do my work. I do my work in Photoshop. Okay, Lightroom is a place for me to get, first of all, to convert my RAW files. It's a place for me to, you know, maybe change some of my white balances because you can batch them. In other words, what I normally do when I go out and shoot an event, I set my white balance for a certain color temperature. If it's a little bit off, it's okay because when I get it back to Lightroom, I can click on just one of them. If they all have the same color temperature, I just batch them, boom, they all go. You know, if I have 1,000 of them in 5 seconds, they're all color calibrated. So I don't change my white balance every time I move around. Otherwise, you know, I'll be changing each image every time I go into Lightroom. So that's something you do not want to do. So you can come, I'm just going to show you a couple things you can do. You can boost contrast, less, more, if that's what you want to do. You could do a saturation. If you want to bring up colors, you can go berserk. Okay, if that's what you want to do. Clarity is going to make it, I'm going to go to the extreme, it's going to make it sharper. All these things I do in Photoshop, I just find, for me, it's a more comfortable place for me. And I can work on layers, so I'm not stuck on one layer, okay? As you move down here, this is like the curves, so you can tell it, you just want, if you notice, if I slide here, or even if I go in, let me put this on. If I go in here, it's showing me on the histogram where exactly it is on the baby's face. So if I come here, these are midtones. If I go into the shadow, you're going to see it's going to drop all the way to the bottom. So this is a pretty cool way of kind of fudging your curves just in Lightroom. I don't do it there. Sorry. Here you can actually target different hues and saturations. So if I want to just make the reds pop, you can see it just hits the reds. That's really very attractive. If I want to do the greens, you notice how the green popped? That's very, you know, by the way, it's very powerful when you can do that. And you can also use this tool here to go just into the greens and bring it, change the colors just by doing that in the window itself, which is kind of cool. I don't do that. I'm going to bring this back to zero. As you move down, we can sharpen it. I do all my sharpening in Lightroom, and I do all my sharpening on a final print. Print ready. I don't sharpen it until I'm ready to go out to print. Remember that sharpening, all this stuff is destructive, so it attacks your pixels. So make sure you know you're doing it on a layer, and you're saving your originals. One thing that I'll tell you to do if you're using Lightroom, make sure every image has remove chromatic aberration. and also click on enable your profiles. Did you notice what happened to the image? Look at the sides. It got lighter and it flattened it out. So it's seeing what camera I used, and it's correcting some of the distortion. Do it on all your images. Most of the times you're going to see it on the edges of your image. Say we shoot a tree. You'll see these cyan, magenta colors that are right on the edges. That's aberration. So this will fix it. Photoshop has a great tool to do it as well, but make sure we do all that. Okay, so once I'm happy and I know it, I'm going to clap my hands. Okay, I know you're waiting for that. I'm going to bring down the exposure just a wee bit. So let's say, maybe a little bit more. Now we talked about resolution. This is where I'm going to tell Lightroom what I want it to do. There's a whole mess of things. You can email right out of here. You could, like I said before, you can make a web show, slideshow. I'm just going to export it to Photoshop because I want to continue to work on it, okay? So I'm going to use a shortcut. Let me go up here. So it's File, it's Export, Export. So I use a shortcut. It's Command-Shift-E. But if you want to use that, you can. It brings you to the export palette. Here, I'm going to tell it what to do. I'm going to say, choose my desktop, because right now, if I'm working at home, I have working files, it'll go in there. For now, I'm just going to put it on the desktop. I'm going to leave it, let it rename it to whatever file name it is. Here, you can tell it what you want it to do. Do you want it to be a Photoshop file, a JPEG file? Do you want it to be an DNG? Do we know what that is, DNGs? Okay, that's, so in case, for some reason, your raw files are never going to be able to be read, DNGs can read them all. Or original, it'll send it out as that raw file, just the way we brought it in. I'm going to send it out as a Photoshop file. And here it's going to tell me what color space. I use Profoto RGB, it's the largest color space, that's what I use. Until I'm ready to go out to my final product, I worry about it there. I want to keep all the possible information that I can. 16-bit, we leave it at 16-bit. And here's where you would tell it what your resolution you want it to be. I normally, I'm at 300. That's where I'm comfortable. I can get huge prints shooting at 300. And here you can tell it what you want it to do after it exports. You can say, don't do anything, just put it on my desktop, open it in Photoshop, open it in other applications, open it in Mail if you want to do Mail, blah, blah, blah. So I'm going to open up in Photoshop. I'm going to export it. Here it is on my desktop. Here's that raw file, and here it is as a PSD. Wow, how time flies when we're having fun. Here's where I determine some of the things that I want to do. Somebody asked me about post-processing and lighting and how I want to do it. Remember I said before I'd rather use, instead of a plain background, what I did behind this child was use a diffuser. And the reason I did that is I wanted to separate her from a background so I could put my own background in there. So let's talk a little bit about that. And this again, will give your client something a little bit extra instead of on a plain old background. Do we know what extractions are, besides your teeth? I got to go to the dentist soon. I don't want to go. Extraction is removing the subject from the background so it becomes transparent so we can do other stuff. And one of the things I use to do that is a program called Fluid Mask. It's probably the best program out there. I'm sponsored by them, but I've tried them all. Photoshop has one that's not bad. But this one is pretty simple because the contrast between the foreground and the background is pretty great, so it's not too difficult. But if you know you want to extract somebody, then make it simple on yourself. They got blonde hair, you're not going to put them on a white background. You're going to put them on something that has contrast to it, and that's what we did here. Fluid Mask is great on hair, so I do a lot of people, so sometimes I want to do something with the background, so I will remove them from the image. So what I would do for this one, and I'm going to do this pretty quick, I'm going to go to Filter. These are one of the plugins that I have. It's called Fluid Mask. And after the program, if anybody has any questions about Fluid Mask, please ask me then, because it's a little bit of a in-depth program. And if you want information on getting it at a discount, just let me know. Give me a card, and we'll talk about it. What I'm going to do is I'm going to use the first brush that comes up and pick out the background, including this black area that I don't want it to go to. So just to show you, I'm going to make the red is what we keep. And we can see it went a little bit too far, but it's not the end of the world. I'm going to come in here, get rid of this gray. I'm going to come a little closer. And the rest I want to keep with green. And I'm going to just go up here, image, fill with a keep color. So let me back up a little bit so you can see what I got. Red, I'm going to get rid of the background. Green, I'm going to keep, okay? So I'm going to lower this so I can see what I have, because it looked like we're missing some areas right here. I can fix this in Photoshop if I wanted to, but let's just do it here. I'm just going to take the green, smaller brush, and you know, make sure I got all these areas here. Come down in here. This needs a little bit. Come around here. I don't know if the fingers, let's take a look at the fingers. The fingers look pretty good. Except for that little spot right in there. That little spot there. Once I'm happy with that, I'm going to save it back to Photoshop. So I was in a different program. Now I'm going to go back to Photoshop. And when we talk about transparency, this is what I mean. Right now, that child is all by herself. And I can do just about anything, which is really very cool. So let's put it back where she was. And before I retouch her anymore, I would normally bring in the background so I don't have any mistakes that I may not have to worry about. So that really looks good. You see her? Isn't that nice? Let's put it behind her. Okay. And now I'm going to come in tight, and we're going to take a look. Here's some areas that I missed, but it did a pretty awesome job. If I come around here, you can see all the little fuzzies. That's what makes for a great. See, I got little boogers there. So you can go both with the erase tool, get rid of that. And you can also take the history brush. This is crazy. History brush. And you can paint in anything that is missing. I could paint back the whole background if I really wanted to. Okay? But all I want to paint back in is just this little pedestal that I missed. So there are some ways you can retouch. If there's some stuff in here like right here, I would just hold down a shift key, do a straight line, boom, boom, and we're good to go. I did it very quickly because I just wanted to show you some of the things that's capable of doing. From here, remember we talked about composition, so let's take her. And let's move her maybe down in here so it's not so dead center. And, you know, at this point, let's make her a little bit smaller because we can. Remember the background, I said, well, it's still competing with her. Let's take the background and let's blur it. Gaussian blur. So this way she pops out of the background. Numbers don't really matter. It's really what you're looking for. I would probably add a little noise to that background so it doesn't look what's the word I'm looking for? Sterile. That's the word. And I would go monochromatic. Monochromatic will give you noise that doesn't have color in it, and that's what we really want. I'm just going to make this a little lower, just a couple of pixels. Maybe two, because you can. And just to show you before and after the background, I'm going to put some more in so you can actually see it. Sorry about that noise. Add noise. Let's pick it up a couple. There we go. So here's the background before and after. So it actually gives it a little more truth to the feeling, so it doesn't just get bent out of shape and looks like it's not real. Another thing I would probably do is, this is very cool, just change the color of this guy here. Color range tool is very, very powerful. This gray here. I'm going to just pick this pretty quickly. I want to pick I just want to pick this bottom piece, and I'm just going to show you. I want to pick the bottom piece and change the color. So here's one way you can do it. And again, I'm doing this really, really quickly because I don't want to spend too much time on showing you about the color. But I just want to show you how it's done. I used a color range tool, very powerful tool, very cool tool. And I'm just going to come in here. Now I'm just adding to the selection. I want to make sure I got it all. Kind of like that, this here. Kind of like that, and this here. I didn't pick that color. I messed up a little bit. And once I have it, I'm just going to say that's good. I'm going to feather it a little bit so the edges aren't so sharp. And then I'm going to put it on its own layer. And then I'm just going to bring up the hue saturation. I can just come in here, and I could pump up saturation, change it to yellows, change it to blues. And the reason I'm showing you that is there's no limit to what you can do. So I can come in here and say I like the blues with less saturation. Just come down there instead of that orange or yellow that it was, so it doesn't look so gross. And once I have that, I can back up a little bit, take a look at it. Now let me show you a little bit of retouching on her so you can get an idea of what this is all about. I'm going to straighten her out a little bit. I'm going to flatten this. Don't do this with your regular images. I'm doing it because of space. So I'm flattening it sometime this month. Flattening it. There we go. I'm going to save it to the desktop just in case something goes crazy. I'm flattening it because I don't want to work on multiple layers right now. I'm on my laptop and memory and stuff like that, so I don't want to work on big files. But if you guys are working on files, by all means, don't flatten your working file. Keep them in layers. And then when you're ready to go out to print, then you would flatten it, save it as a TIFF, and move on out to wherever you're going. Okay? So what are some of the things we can do with this little baby? We can see where the light's coming from, which is good. When we're talking about normal two-thirds, loop light or Rembrandt lighting, we're talking about the catch light in the eyes, depending on which side of the face is coming in through, is usually around 10 o'clock. So that's just about 10 o'clock, and that's what I mean by this right up here. This little catch light is at 10 o'clock. The lighting's coming from the other side, then we'd be looking around 2 o'clock. Otherwise you can't take the portrait? No, but if we're looking for proper lighting and you have time to do that, especially if you're doing a studio shot, you do have the time to do that and set it up. You don't want the lights too low, because if it's too low, you're going to get this ghoul type of lighting. The shadow's going to go too high. You don't want it too high because you won't have no light in the eye. So these are all the little things you have to think about when you're working on your portraits. Okay? So how do I introduce light that you saw some of my things in Haiti? Let me show you. There's so many different ways of doing it. I'm going to show you one example here, then we'll open up another image, and I'll show it to you on another image as well. Which one am I going to use on this one? Okay. Let's use a brush. I'm adding a new layer, so all the painting that I'm going to do is going to be on a new layer. Right here, you see layer one is a new layer. Get my brush, let it be. Change the mode from normal, to multiply. Make sure my foreground color is white. So if I paint, that really looks attractive. Okay, I just wanted to show you, I went to the extreme. Okay, so what do I do? Well, I want to enhance the direction of light so we can start to build up more dimension in this face. She's beautiful, and it can get better. So I'm going to work on a very low opacity. I'm on 10% right now. As you can see right up here, it's 10%. I have my brush. It's in white. It's multiply mode on a new layer. Then I'm going to start looking at some of the areas that we know light should be hitting. One of the areas would be the bridge of the nose. All the highlight areas that are high on the face, like tip of the nose, little areas here, I'm just going to start painting them in very, very little bit. I'm not going to go berserk. Top of the eye would be another place we'd like to see some light. Okay. Another place we'd like to see the light is on the forehead. So we come in here and just jab it just a little bit. If we see too much of it, and we're on another layer, so I can always, I just want to show you, we haven't even done anything, and I'm just starting to build it, okay? The chin is another place we want to hit. Right about there. Another place we want to hit is the lips. They always look beautiful on little babies. So I'm just going to come in here and just highlight the lips a little bit. They call this, what do they call it, the angel's thing on top of the nose? I forget what they call it, but this thing here. So I would come in here and do the same thing here. What is it? The isthmus. Love that word. I'm going to back up a little bit. Take another look. I just want to go from before and after. So we're starting to build it up. I'm not going to leave it at 100%, but I just want to show you how we start to build up. The eyes I always do separately because they're just a little more involved. So once I have that, I'm also going to add a little bit to the other side of the face, right about here where we have that little loop light. So right about in here. You know, and I'm also going to go maybe a little more to the extreme so you can really see it. And then once I'm happy with that, I'm going to just bring this down a little bit and start dialing it in until I'm happy. And I'm about, and the numbers really aren't relevant. It really depends on your taste. I don't want it all the way up here. I don't want it all the way down here, but I do want to bring it in somewhat so we can see a little nice little lighting coming in. So I'm going to leave it about, I don't know, 85% is good. I'm going to flatten this. And I'm going to work on the eyes now. Same thing, I'm going to put a new layer. Come into the eyes. Be very careful. This is where a lot of people make mistakes. They just make it look ghoulish. Just a little bit. Start the whites of the eyes. Don't forget the bottom of the whites of the eyes should be a little bit brighter than the top. I know it sounds stupid, but it does. Just come in here. Back up a little bit. Make sure that you don't make it look possessed. And if it does, just take it. You're going to take it down a notch. And it does a little bit for me. So I'm just going to bring it down a little bit. Whoops. And again, that's what where you want to tell the story, you know, especially with eyes. That needs to tell a story. Then I'd probably come in here. I very rarely use the dodge and burn tool. In this case, I could, or I can continue to use this brush in multiply mode. And don't forget, we have on the opposite side of the catch light, we have this little moon. And here's where we want to dig in there, fill that in. Back up a little bit. Again, go from 0 to 100 and anywhere in between and see what you like. You can pop the color of the eyes if you want. I'm not going to do that right now. Then, so let's take a look. Now we're starting to see some direction, and that's what we're looking for. Once we have that, what's another way that we can make her kind of pop out of the image a little bit more? I guess we can do some dodging, some burning. So bring down the background a little bit. A couple of different ways of doing that as well. The way I do it is, new layer. I use a soft light, and I fill with 50% gray. Now you can see I have a new layer that's filled with 50% gray. And the reason why I do that, I find that it doesn't distort the colors that we're trying to burn in. When I use the burn tool, especially on someone's face, it seems to change the colors, and I'm not happy about that. So here we're going to use a brush, black brush. I'm going to do it really high so you can get an idea of, you know, we can start burning in this way. There's so many ways of burning in. There's applications that do vignettes for you. You can do it yourself. But this is another way. This is another way for you to build up dimension. So I would probably come in here 20% and start building in shadows as well, because that is the other equation of the dimension, not just highlights, but shadows. If you want to make this darker so it's not so obvious, you come in here and start darkening this down as well, as you can see. Doesn't change the color, which is nice, and that's why I use this procedure. Come in here, just make sure that you understand where the lighting is coming from and work that. I'm going to come in here, again, just make it look like it's really got some pop and pizzazz. Now, what I would have probably done before is, when I didn't have a layer, when I had the layers on before, I would darken my background then, so I'm not going to go too crazy on it, but here's before and after. And you can see how that's starting to build up some dimension right there just by adding some shadow. So it's a combination of highlight and shadow that's going to get us to where we want to go. Okay? I'm going to accept that. I'm just going to save that. Another way I could take this image, make a copy of it, take my curves, make the whole image darker if I want the background to go a little bit darker. And then I'm going to add a layer mask, so I'm going to hide it. So now I can take a brush, white, and I can come in here. I'm going to multiply, that's no good, normal. Come in here, and I can start making the background darker from that curves adjustment that I just did. I'm just making the background darker, just using curves. Photoshop as a whole, I don't have to tell you guys, you understand. Photoshop takes forever to try to teach everybody everything. Well, as much as I know anyway, and I probably only know just a wee bit. Again, I can darken this down too, so this way she kind of falls in. So I don't want to spend too much time on, I want to show you the technique for me to go, and I'm going to show it to you again. I just don't want to spend too much time on it because it'll take forever for me to dissect every little nook and cranny of this. I just want to show you different ways of getting to the same point. In other words, I'm going to do another one and show you how I work on that with using different tools, but it gets me to the same point. It depends on what you're comfortable with, what tools you like. Photoshop can get you to the same place in many, many different ways. Okay, so let me close this. Let me see if I have window history. So we went from that all the way down to that. Something that, again, I think you'd be proud to give your client. Something that's a little bit different. Something that I think your average amateur photographer is probably not going to be doing. So if you, this is something that interests you, please, continue to take a deeper look into it, okay? So let me go into Lightroom. And let me go back to my grid mode so I can see what I have. This is some of the images that maybe we're gonna actually print out the parachute. Brings back old memories. So remember before we talked about these modules. As we go through some of these different modules, this is the one that I spend most time in. Although I can print out a Lightroom as well. I'm going to print out a Photoshop today because if you don't have Lightroom, most of us have Photoshop. I just want to show you how it's done out of Photoshop, how we manage the colors. And so this way our Photoshop and the printer understands each other, because that's, I think a lot of people get a little confused on that. Sometimes they double profile. Very important to get the right profiles, okay? You can do the same thing in Lightroom, exact same thing, but I'm choosing to do it in Photoshop because I think more people will probably have that. So that's the print module. What's really nice about it, they have preset templates, so you can set up templates if you want to do that. This one's set right now to 13 by 19, so that's why it fits perfectly in there. And you can see here's the size down here shows a little border. This is where I would do my color management. I would not do, and same thing in Photoshop, you would not want the printer to color manage it. You want Photoshop to color manage it, or you want, and here you would pick the profile, and I'm going to go show you, I will be showing you that. The web is very cool. Let me get. I can make a web page, a very quick web page, and upload it. I do this a lot for my clients who I've shot for, and I upload it. I give them the address where to go. They click on it. I got a little baby website. I can put, you know, I can change the titles, everything, and and I can also change the size of the previews when it opens up. Right down here, it's set. So if I click on it, it's set for 450 pixels. So that's, you know, if you want to make it bigger, you just say, I want it bigger. I want 700 pixels. It's redoing it right now. So it'll make it bigger and bigger and blah, blah, blah. So it's actually a pretty cool way of getting your work out there very quickly so people can see it. You don't have to email it to them. You just have to send it up someplace that has an FTP. My website has an FTP, so I just put it up on my website as a separate little web page, okay? So that's very cool. I talked to you a little bit about this book module. Come up. This is very, very cool. Here's where you pick your images and you make your own templates. It comes with, you can make your own collections. You can make pages, save them. You can do all kinds of neat stuff. You can download templates from Blurb. It's nonstop. I'm going to do one. I haven't had a chance to play around yet through Lightroom. I've done Blurb before. I wasn't crazy about what they gave me because I did black and whites, and I wasn't, you know what? I'm hoping that now that they're hooked up with Adobe, I'm hoping that they pick up the pace a little bit, and, you know, now that they're working together, because you would think Adobe would want them to give them the best product possible. So I want to give them another try and see what happens. The map, stop it. This will tell you where your images are. If you put your GPS on your image, it reads your data from your camera and it puts it on here. Stop it. They're making me crazy. Okay, so let me go in here. Let's open up something. Let's open up this guy. This guy shot in Maine when I went to Maine. I'm going to use some plugins on here so you can get an idea of what they do. I'm not going to remove them from the background. What I'm going to do is I'm going to retouch them a little bit, see what needs retouching, little dodge, little burn, and then how to pop the image, how to really give it a little more structure to it by using, matter of fact, we'll use a couple of different ones. We'll use Adjust, maybe we'll go into Nick, and we'll use some of them as well. Okay, so let's take a look at this guy. Good-looking face to begin with. Doesn't need much work, that's for sure. But I want to do what I did before, add some highlights. I'm going to use a different method this time so I can show you a couple of different ways that we do it. This one, I'm going to add a new layer. See, I'm going to get a white brush as my foreground, very similar to before. But I'm not using it in multiply mode. I'm using them in regular mode. And I'm going to use a little bit of a harder brush. And I just want to see how much I got there. That's a little bit too much. So I'm going to bring it down to about 10%. I'm going to come a little closer so you can see what I'm doing. And like before, I'm trying to see where the lighting is coming from. It's coming from, as we're looking at the image, coming from the left side, his right side of his face. So that's where we want to make sure that those highlights follow suit. So let me make this a little bit smaller. I'm going to a little more than that, and maybe a little more than that. So I'm going to come in here and start. This really looks attractive, I know. But please, hang in there with me. I'm going to put a little bit under the eyes, a little bit on top of the eyes like we did before, a little bit on the forehead. That's really nice, Jim. A little bit down here. This is just other ways that you can get to the same effect. Let me make this a little bit smaller. Beep. Come down, do here. I'm not going to go crazy on this. Okay, that looks attractive. Now, let's put one on this side. By the way, do we know the shortcut for the brush? This is really cool. If you use Photoshop a lot, please use this shortcut. If you hold down the Option Control key or the Alt Control key on a PC, if you go horizontally, it makes it bigger and smaller. If you go vertically, it makes it softer and harder. It's really very cool, and it saves you a ton of time. Let me just hit that over there, and I'll hit a little bit over here. Sorry, guys. Now, so let's go to filter. Let's go to blur, Gaussian blur. Now let's just blur the crap out of this until we get it to where we want. And then don't forget, we have this thing that we could use from anywhere from nothing. So I'm just going to pump it just a little bit, just to give it a little. Again, you don't need a lot. So this is before, after. I'm about 60%. And I see some areas that I need to take it away from, and that's okay. So you can do it with a layer mask. You got to make sure that it doesn't encroach upon the eyes 100%. So I'll just show you real close in what I'm talking about. So I'm at 100%. I could take all those highlights away if I want to, but I don't. I just want to do it on the eyebrows. Make sure the eyes are clean. Keep them all clean. Back up a little bit. Make sure the teeth are clean. The beard right in here. You don't want to lose contrast over there. You just want it enough just to give it a little bit of direction. So from just enough. Because remember, we're going to darken some areas down too, remember, like we did before. So that's going to have that contrasty look as well. I'm going to add maybe 10%, take a little bit off his chin, and I'm happy with that. I'm going to flatten that. Okay. I want to show you some of the things. Let's take adjust, for example. So I'm going to make a copy of the layer. Command or Control J. And now you see I'm working on another layer of the same image. I just don't want to work on the original. I want to make sure that I'm able to either use my opacity, use a layer mask to take or bring stuff back. So that's really, really very important. So let's go to adjust. I'm going to go to adjust topaz, adjust 5. It has its own selections of presets here. You can go berserk. One of the things, so I'm going to go to the extreme so you can see what it's doing. Let's go to detail. Wow. Okay. I've seen a lot of images just like this. Really, all kidding aside, you see a lot of people are doing this, and the grunge thing is cool, but you can grunge it without going berserk. Okay, there's ways of controlling this. Some areas I really like it, and some areas I don't like it. So let's just take it at its worst, and we'll say, okay. So what I do now is I add a layer mask. And again, this is a whole other thing in Photoshop. A layer mask is going to allow me to paint in or paint out areas that I don't want. That's basically what it is. So down in this area here are layer masks. I want to fill it the layer with black so it takes away all the effect. So watch this little white box right up here. I'm going to fill it with black. Now it's filled with black. Now he looks like he did when we did nothing.
Is there a shortcut?
Yes. You can option when you hit the layer mask, hold down the option key or the alt key. If not, it comes up. You can also do command or control I to invert it. Either one of those will work. Make sure that you select the layer mask. The way you know it's selected, it has a little bracket going around it, so it's selected. Okay, I'm going to go to the extreme once again so you can see what I'm doing. Since this is a black layer mask, for me to show what's happening on this layer, I have to paint in white, the opposite. So I have a white brush. You can see my foreground color is white down in here. I have my brush. I'm going to put it on 100% just to show you. It's hard, just to show you what I'm doing. Okay, so I can now have the ability to paint wherever I want to paint it. So let's think about that a little bit. What do I really want to show in this face? The hair, I think, is really important. His beard, I'd like to pop that a little bit as well. And maybe the shirt, I don't know. Let's just play a little bit. So I'm going to come in here. I'm not going to use a hard edge brush. I'm going to use a very soft edge brush. So you can see, I'm just going to drag it so it's very soft. I'm not going to use 100% because I want to be able to paint it in gradually. That's what it's all about. You don't want to go berserk. So let's just go 40%. And I'm going to start painting in his around the hair area. Notice what it does. It actually picks up some of the highlights. I'm going to come right in here. Don't forget, we are on a layer. We can make this as strong or as light as we want. I'm going to come in here. Look at his beard. I want this to pop. This is what I want to really show. This is his character. This is what it's all about on his face. That's what I see anyway. Mustache. Just come in here. Maybe a little bit on the lips. You may want to sharpen the eyes a little bit. Okay. Let's take a look at his clothing. You know, for me, I don't have a problem with it being out of focus, but if you want to bring in some detail, if there's something, jewelry or something like that, I certainly would come in there and do that. Earrings, all these little things that you take upon yourself to sharpen, selective sharpening, we call it, that is what makes your image really sing. It just it brings your viewer's eyes to these areas that that they wouldn't do because they perceive this, they perceive sharpness and it brings their eyes into those areas. I wouldn't do it on the background because I didn't like what it did to the background. Just to show you, it added more interest to the background. I don't want that. I want less interest. I want it on the person's face. So how about his face? Yeah, I think I kind of like a little grunge on his face, but not like 100%. So let's go in here and just pick up just a wee bit, 20%. I'm going to back up a little bit. So right now I went from that to that. That's quite a big difference without hardly doing anything. I think the best way to explain it is it's a painting process. No matter what I do, it's never 100%. It's always gradual, be it light, be it filters, whatever the case might be, it's a process of building on it. Otherwise, you're going to have just a mess. So be gradual, take it slow, and you'll get it. All right, so that's topaz. That was adjust. I'm going to get rid of this layer. Let's go to let's go back to adjust. Let's go back to topaz. Filter topaz. Like I said, this is a whole bundle, but they can be bought separately. If anybody's interested, I can give you a link. And it's 15% off of any of them. Let's go to detail 3. They range. They're very, very reasonable. Anywhere from, I think, $29.95 to $59 or $69.95 is the top. They're really reasonable. They really are. They have one coming up, actually, for adjust. And I have it on my phone. I'll show it to you later. So let's go to, this is new, in focus. So let's go down a little bit so we can see this guy. Hello? Let's see why it's not showing me the whole image. I'm thinking. Give me a second. All right. Just let me do this. It won't. This went to 1. I got it all the way down to the bottom. Why is that doing that? Just give me 1 second. Let me think. There's always a reason. I'm looking for, where is?
Original on the left
there? Original on the left. No, it's not that. Let's see. I just, believe it or not, I just loaded that in, and that's bad. Let me see what happens with detail. There could be a bug in it. That's possible. Yeah, that's the way it should have been. All right, let's go to detail. And not only does it do things that are grungy, it can do something just the opposite. If you like, soft. If you're doing smooth. This, they have different collections, so if you want the skin to be smooth, I wouldn't want to do it on this, but if you're doing a child, you may want to do something soft and dreamy, and it really, really does a nice job. I'm going to show you this. Look what it does to the highlights on a little baby. So we went from that to that, and it does a really nice job of softening. And of course, you can do a layer mask, take it off the eyes so the eyes continue to be sharp, and all the other areas that you want sharp, like the teeth and the lips, you probably want to keep them sharp too. So those are a couple of different little plugins that you can play around with Topaz. Also, let me just go through a couple of these for you. Topaz, they also have Denoise. Denoise is a program that will allow you to reduce some noise in your image, which is kind of nice. There's so many out there. They have a masking program, and I'm ashamed to say I don't use it because I use Topaz. I just find I use Fluid Mask. I just find it to be easier, and sorry, that's what I do. They have a star effect. If you're doing glass silverware, you can put stars on there. It's all kinds of crazy stuff. They have a black and white. Their black and white actually is very good. I just haven't given it a lot of time, and I really should, and I guess I will, but I still use silver effects. That's where I'm really comfortable right now until I get my butt into using Topazes. All right, so let me close this guy up. By the way, this is the first time I'm working on this machine. No excuses. We work on a 9900. I also don't print out of Photoshop. We use a RIP. A RIP is an application that you take your image into, and it does all its calculations in that RIP. It has nothing to do with Photoshop. I use what they call image print. Amazing. You still have to use the profiles. Speaking of profiles, let me show you very quickly how Moab does their profiling. If you go down there and download any of their products, alongside of it, it'll tell you the product, obviously. It'll also tell you what this is the profile you're downloading. It tells you what media to set your application for. So, and I'm going to show it to you in a second. So we're going to do Slick Rock, which is a pretty brand new product that's pretty amazing, very highly reflective. So when you download their profile, you go to Moab's ICC page, you'll see this. So what we're using today is the Slick Rock Metallic. I downloaded it for the 3880, okay? It's telling me to use the media type is Ultra Premium Luster Paper. That's the media type. And it also tells me this is not for all papers, but they recommend that you use the the relative rendering intent instead of perceptual. Okay, this paper needs its own little stuff to get going. And once it goes, boy, it's really, really nice. So we want to make sure we use relative, and we use the ultra premium paper luster. Hopefully it'll show up on this printer. Okay, so we're going to take this guy. I'm going to drag him to the desktop. This image is 5,700 pixels, if we're speaking pixels. Here we are. We're in Photoshop. Here's some of the things you want to do. Like I said before, my layer is flattened. Make sure you have no channels, no extra channels hiding in there. Make sure they're, you know, you didn't do something like a mask or something. Then we'll, just like any other program, let's go into the print module. So, is this on and running? Let's see. Oh, my butt. Okay, here's where we do our settings. Here's where a lot of people make a mistake. Color handling. The printer manages colors? No. Photoshop manages colors. And look what happens. Let me go back. Printer manages colors. I can't even attach a profile to it. See, it's grayed out? That's a problem. I want to attach a profile. So Photoshop manages colors, and now we can go find that profile. And what is the profile we wanted? Go down to Moab, Metallic, Epson, 3880. We click on that. It's good. 16-bit. Remember we talked about the intent? They suggest we use the relative, and that's what it's on. Now we have to go into the print settings, into the layout, and print the settings. Here's where we set the media type. Remember we talked about before the media type? So they're asking us to use, I don't see the setting in here, unfortunately, unless it's on the others. Let me see. No. So we're going to have to use something that's as close as possible, and that's the premium photo paper glossy. Okay? For some reason, did you say ultra? Was it ultra? Yeah, it was ultra. Okay. So the ultra premium photo luster, I think both of those profiles will give you a take to where you want to go to. What's happening here? Let's look at the... Let me show, we've got the... borderless sheet feeder. We should put paper in there now. Call me crazy. This paper's crazy. Front side forward, otherwise it could get ugly. All right, let me see why I'm not getting the right size. Let's go to, we went through this before, sheet feeder borderless. We don't want auto expand. That's why I use a rip. What is this? Let me see. Let's go here. 11, no. Sheet feeder borderless retained size. That sounds better. Let's try that. Where did we go crazy with this the last time? What did we do? Save. This is good. Premium. Da-da-da. Save. And what happened here? Let's see. Center. Did center that. Scale to fit. There we go. I don't know why. Swallow the fly. Maybe she'll die. Okay. This is scale to fit, but I still don't understand why that does that. What about... Yeah. Oh, okay. Now it's centered. That's what I wanted to do. Okay. So... Just to go over that again, we're talking about obviously picking the right printer. We talked about the print setting. We know that Photoshop manages the colors. If not, we're going to get something that's pretty bad. Okay, it's not going to look good. We're going to have, we can also have double profiling. We're using the manufacturer's profiles. By the way, Jim Roselli, my partner, we do custom profiling for Moab as well. He's crazy. I want to keep as much data as possible. Now, once we do that, we did the print setting, we picked the media paper, and we're ready to go. So we hit print, we wait for a nice music, some sound. Let me make sure I didn't shut off my driver. I hear something. All right, so the settings. The profile tells the printer, is it matte paper? Is it luster paper? That's what the profile is telling. So if we're attaching this profile to the image, we have to let the driver know that. And the way to do that is say Photoshop is managing the color for this. Otherwise, it's not going to recognize the profile, and it's just going to print. It's going to look like a mess. So that's really, really very, very important. You got to pick the right profiles and the... and the right media setting also. This is really beautiful. It didn't center it. I don't know why. Swallow the fly. But can you turn the lights up? But I just want you to pass this around, please. Look at a beautiful beautiful paper.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.